Today, I interview with Charlene Li, founder, managing partner at the Altimeter Group, and New York Times bestselling author. Please join us on this episode of Substance. Charlene, I'm really excited to have you here on Substance.
Well, thank you for having me.
Thank you for being here. Now you've been on 60 Minutes and on Substance, so now you can say that you've been here.
Exactly. I'm really looking forward to this conversation. This is going to be a lot more fun.
Great. Well, it's on camera. She said that. No, I'm kidding. So I would love to just talk a little bit about your, not just how you started the Altimeter Group, mm-hmm. but going back before that, what kind of prepared you for running a company like Altimeter?
Well, I think one of the earliest things I did was coming out of business school, deciding not to go the traditional consulting and investment banking route. I came out of Harvard Business School and went into newspapers. Not exactly a really stellar career move in most of my classmates' minds. But this was in 1993, and it was at the beginning of this thing called the internet. Nobody knew what it was. It was like AOL and CompuServe and a bunch of big telecom companies. And I decided that I wanted to go into the content space, and especially newspapers, because I figured in this new space, newspaper content would be the first stuff to actually move online and would be able to take advantage of whatever things would come along in the digital space.
Sure.
So I made bets really early on. But being in media, being at the birth of this new age, was really exciting, being in Silicon Valley, the San Jose Mercury News. So from there, just starting lots of different projects and things, being an entrepreneur inside a company, mm-hmm. Really helped me think very independently, gain a lot of confidence in my judgment to predict what these trends were. Went to Forrester, continued looking at the new trends, picked up this whole social space, wrote a book around it. And eventually, I just went, this is something I wanted to do.
You wrote the book, you wrote your book in while you were at Forrester?
Yes, exactly. Okay. Not something that most analysts do. But again, it's sort of the history that I have, that I keep starting things, just not necessarily on my own. And you have to realize, I was at Forrester at the time when all of my classmates and so many people were doing dot-com startups in 1998, 99, 2000. Mm-hmm. And I was analyzing it, chomping at the bit, saying, I want to get in the action. And I never did, because I realized that in my heart of hearts, I love being an analyst. Mm. I love writing and thinking and doing all these things, working with companies. But then I realized I also had this urge to be an entrepreneur, too. I kept starting new things, and writing a book is in of itself a whole new venture. So enjoyed writing books, wrote a second book, now starting work on the third, getting up the energy to do that. It's a lot of energy and effort to put a book together. So I just enjoy that endeavor of creating things.
I want to talk about this new book, but before we go there, tell me a little bit about what you were thinking when you started Altimeter, because it's a different kind of company. Mm-hmm. It's a different kind of analyst company, and you give away your thought leadership, I think, mm-hmm. as I understand it. Was that on purpose? Did you guys see this as a different company? How did that come together?
We absolutely believed that it was something different. So when I left Forrester, there were so many good things about that company. But one of the big albatrosses around the company's neck was that it had to constantly create research to justify the fees that they were charging for the syndicated research. And I just felt that that was a little bit unbalanced because of the influence race that you had to go do. And it's also just as a startup company, to get people to pay for just one or two pieces of content didn't make any sense. Also, I was looking at the stuff that we wanted to write around disruptive new technologies. You're better off getting more people to read it than fewer, putting it behind a firewall. Mm. So the business model was to always open mm-hmm. the research, but not just open in terms of giving it away, open up the whole research process. Mm-hmm. So we invite anybody and everybody to come in and help us write the research. We talk about the areas that we're going to be researching. We just put out the trends pieces of what are the trends we're watching. We don't do predictions. Mm-hmm. We talk about what are the trends that are interesting. Mm-hmm. And we tell people, this is what we're looking at, researching, and why it's important for organizations to think about them. So we're welcoming anybody and everybody to come into that dialogue, because we know we're not the smartest people in the room, but we hopefully can create some analysis, do some research that will help organizations.
So how has this business helped shape you? How have you grown through this business?
I think it was one of the best and scariest things I ever did. I left Forrester in 2008. And you know what happened in the fall of 2008? I got three clients in August, and then the crash happened. So I was very lucky, and it hit the market at the right time and happened to be covering something like social, which people were very excited about because it was a way to replace their non-existent marketing budgets then in 2009, 2010. So it hit the market at a really good time. Was very lucky to have some great partners, people early on. And when people ask me, what's the best part about starting your own company? Is it the freedom, the control? It really isn't that.
It's the food, right?
It's, well, we do have good snack food. We call it brain food. It's, I think in the end, it's really about working with a group of people who would believe in the same mission and the purpose and have the same values as you do. Mm-hmm. So when you go to work, it feels like it's home. Mm-hmm. And the people that I'm working with, we're united and trying to do the same thing. So that is really gratifying to know that we've created that kind of little space and time and place.
So now let's travel forward a little bit into where we're at now, where technology is at. How do you see the environment progressing forward when we're in such a innovative space and we're trying to figure out what disruption actually is? I mean, can you disrupt at a time when everything seems to innovate? Everything, there's so much noise around technology.
Right. In many ways, I think disruption is a way of life. And this is the research that I'm doing right now, is we constantly talk about the need to be innovative, to stay on top of things, and how do you create a more innovative organization. I would say actually innovation is just sort of table stakes at this point. And that if you want to stay ahead of the competition, and especially the new entrants who are coming in trying to disrupt your existing industry and your organization, then you have to be disruptive yourself. You have to constantly think about, if I were in somebody else's shoes, how would I destroy my business? And then turn around and actually do it. And that is probably one of the hardest things to do as an organization, to say, here's my cash cow. Here's something that's working beautifully, I think. People seem to be happy. It's working well. I can try to optimize it. It shouldn't be about optimizing. It should be about, how do I kill this thing? How do I just make something even better? So the most disruptive companies that are out there are constantly doing that. They're constantly saying, how do I take something that my customers are really happy and make it better, even if they initially don't like it? They're not asking for it.
Can you be a... Actually, let me phrase it this way. Is there a difference between being a small business and a large business, meaning an enterprise, and being able to disrupt? Can one disrupt versus the other a little bit faster?
I think the smaller enterprises can obviously work a lot faster and be more focused on one thing, whereas large organizations have the scale. And I think we underestimate the power of scale. So the smaller organization can be more nimble, can be more agile, focus on something with laser focus, and do something really well. And hopefully, it'll get traction and slowly grow from that. Now, the big organization can kind of just watch those smaller organizations and just be a fast follower, or just acquire them and then do that exact same thing, but with scale. If they already have a customer base versus the small enterprise that has to find that customer base, they've got it made. The problem is those big organizations can't recognize it. They can't absorb that disruption in. They can't change the way they do things. So I do believe that if big organizations could just move on the scale from 1 to 2 out of 10 in terms of innovation, because they have so much scale, they can just keep the market for themselves.
So what is disruption? Disruption 10 years ago versus disruption today?
I think disruption is fundamentally at the core. Has always been the same. It's when a new innovation comes along that upsets the status quo. And little innovations along the way can just kind of make things better, but it doesn't change the relationship between businesses and the customers or with each other. It doesn't change the power shifts. Disruption changes power shifts. It moves power from you to me. I have more information now. I have more customers. They can understand them. I'm giving them better convenience at a more affordable price. I'm simplifying things even for them. Those are all things that can be disruptive. It's any time you take something that's really complicated and not working very well. Those are all opportunities for disruption.
So now, speaking as a mom and as a business owner and as a leader in technology, I think you're one of the top 100 people, most influential or most powerful technological people in something that I read. And I'm sure you've got like a list of things. You've got all these things going on in your life. How is that disruption happening for you? How are you able to actually manage your life and the things that you have in front of you? You have this now new book coming out.
Yeah, I have to say that I really limit. I put myself on a media diet, information diet, because I have to be really focused on the things I need to know. So people often, I was just talking this morning to a group in San Francisco. They were like, how do you keep on top of everything?
Yeah.
Of all these changes, what are the things that you read? And I'm like, you know, I really don't read that much. I do not read a constant feed. I kind of get caught sometimes because people will say, you know, your colleague just wrote this great post. I'm like, what post? I work with them, I have no idea what they're writing about. It's kind of embarrassing in some ways. But I'm being really laser focused on the issues I've identified as really important. So that focus, picking those things and making those bets, and just having lots of years of experience, kind of getting a good sense of what is important, what's not, and having a lot of those that I'm picking up along the way. So as a mom, one of the coolest things, I have two teenagers, you know, they go, hey, mom, have you heard about this new thing? I'm like, oh, yeah, I tweeted about it yesterday.
Oh, fun.
You know, so it's kind of fun being with my teenagers. I'm playing their games, you know, understand what's going on, keeping up with them on Snapchat and stuff like that. So
they have got to think you are the coolest mom ever.
They think I'm pretty cool. They think I'm pretty hip, but I'm still a mom. I like to say that my whole goal in life is to be a hip mom. Be one of those hip mom, you know, hipster moms. And my daughter says to me, you know, just the fact that you say that makes you so unhip. So, you know, I'm still a mom at heart. But they think it's pretty cool that I bring home cool glasses from Google and fun toys and tools and things like that.
Oh, fun.
Yeah.
Very fun. So, okay, let's shift back just a little bit in back into now this disruption in the context of now social business, because we've got social business, we've got disruption itself, and then we have innovation. Now, does social business and innovation, and are they still playing well together?
Oh, yeah, I think one of the reasons why I came into this whole disruption and innovation space is because I see a lot of organizations going through early stages of disruption because of social. Social causes a lot of those relationships that I talk about to be questioned, to be brought up. Social inside the enterprise, well, what does that say about my relationship as a boss, as a manager, as an executive, when anybody can talk back to me and I'm expected to talk back to them in these social channels? And so executives are very, very much disrupted from their everyday life because there's a change in that relationship, that power shift happening. Same thing with customers. My customers can talk back to me now. Big, huge disruption. And they expect me to know who they are and tweeting me in the middle of the night, and they expect me to talk back to them? That's a shift in the power relationship again. So I keep going back to that relationship, and social is about relationships. And that's what's causing all that disruption and why people are so fearful of it, but also so drawn to it because of the potential of it to really change and create competitive advantage. And that's all business is really, how can I get advantage over my competition to serve my customers better?
Now, tell me a little bit more about this walking the plank idea. You were just talking about this off screen.
So the idea about being disruptive all the time is really pushing yourself and your organization to think very disruptively. So one of the exercises I do with organizations is to brainstorm, what are the craziest things that you could do to your business? Assume that you're not in this business, but you have the assets available to you, the people, the resources, the skills, the customers. What could you do? What are the craziest things? And when you remove those constraints of your existing business, you can start really thinking very creatively. And we just push them all the way to the end, keep pushing. Well, if you could do that, what else could you do? What else could you do? Get crazier and crazier. And then at some point, you just go, that is just totally insane. There's no way that would ever fly. And you go back one step. You walk up to the very edge of that plank. You're about to fall off of it. You take one step back, and you're sitting at the end of that plank, bouncing up and down. Not a very secure place to be. But that's where you need to live. You need to live at the very end of that plank. Walk all the way to the very end. Look over this end. See the total chaos, the sharks swimming down below. And just hang out there. It's not a very comfortable place to be. And it's a place where I think we have to, as organizations and leaders, start feeling very comfortable because that's where our competition is. That's where the new entrants are. I like to bring into these workshops a big bottle of Tums because you will just feel a pit in your stomach the entire time you're doing this. And if you're doing it right, that's about what you should be feeling.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah, because if you don't have that urgency, that sort of anxiety to be out there at the edge, you're not fighting hard enough. You're not pushing yourself fast enough. You're not failing enough, frankly.
So if Tums is listening, they could be a sponsor for
you. I think that would be great. We should call them up. Yeah, one of the things around disruption, people think about disruption as a very negative thing. And we try to get all the disruptions in our life out of our life. And in many ways, what I'm looking for in my research is to say, how do you make disruption a part of your life? How do you build resilience in yourself as a leader and as your organization to be able to deal with all of that turmoil, to be able to live at that edge on a constant basis and perform really well?
How do you, once you are there, it seems like you're not on autopilot, but getting there is the hard part. Getting to the edge. What are a couple of the switches? What are a couple of the things that people can be thinking about that helps them to get there?
I think the biggest one is, how do you fail? Most organizations, especially with social media now, so visible, all you want to do is talk about your successes. We talk about the veneer of Facebook, that everybody just puts out the good news and never talk about the struggles. You read all these case studies of companies, how well they've done. You want to lift up the blanket and just really show and talk about all the failures too, because otherwise you put this veneer on that and this sort of assumption that everything just works perfectly well in your organization, and we know that's never true. I look at companies like Facebook and Google, and one of the things that they do really well is they celebrate failure. They expect people to fail. They expect that if you haven't gone up there and pushed yourself fast enough and you're not failing enough, you haven't really been really trying. So I think organizations that have a systematic way to fail are going to be the ones who do really well at disruption.
What do you think of the term fail fast, fail often?
Yeah, I love that. And I think it's fail smart, too. I absolutely believe in that. I talk to my team all the time, I'd rather have you ask for forgiveness. I'd rather you just, you know, try three things, have two of them fail, one of them work. Because we'll know not to do those two things again, and we'll continue doing that one thing. But we won't push ourselves fast enough unless we do this. And it's not very pleasant. But know why we're doing this. If we have a very clear mission of what we're trying to do and why we're doing this and why we're failing, and that will give us a lot of peace in many ways and understanding to know that, okay, that wasn't a very fun failure, but what did we learn from that? Well, we learned a lot.
So part of disrupting, or part of the makeup of all of this, has to be culture. In order to disrupt, you need that culture to work hand in hand. What does the future of work look like?
Oh, that's a great question. It's a part of my research going on right now, which is looking at how organizations are trying to design a future of ways that people work. And lots of trends like globalization, technology, just demographic shifts. How do I work with millennials, for example, are causing people to think about, well, maybe work can be in a different way, not just coming to an office. So remote working, mobility, flexibility of time, pushing space apart. So the interesting thing in our research is that there are the organizational behavior people who look at the future of work and talk about the flattening of organizations, the flexibility of time, the ability to have accountability and autonomy. And then there's all the other people who talk about enterprise mobility, BYOD, bring your own device. And the two of them almost don't talk to each other. And so of looking at companies who actually have a holistic view of work, everything from, if I'm going to flatten the hierarchy, how am I actually going to do that? Increase the number of people reporting to me from like 7 to 50 to be effective in that way. And you can't do that without technology. So companies like Dell are now saying, by the year 2020, we believe that 50% of our workforce, half of our workforce, will have some sort of flexible work arrangement. That says it's not just a technology issue. That's an issue for the business manager that says, how do I develop the skills to be able to trust my employees that they are doing the things that they said they would do when they're not in the office and I can't see actually what they do? That demands a whole different type of relationship again between the manager and the employee, and even amongst employees doing self-management. So I think we're going to see some new ways of how organizations think about the way organizations are structured, because it's very hierarchical right now, and the reality is work doesn't happen that way. It's much more loose and breaking down silos. It's very chaotic. So that's what I'm looking at.
Give me an example. Who's a company that's doing something like this?
Well, I'll give a quick example from Altimeter. One of the interesting things that we look at is what is a contract between an employer and an employee, and what does that relationship look like? And for some reason, we come into organizations and think that it's going to be a lifelong contract. We assume that person's going to stay there for unknown amounts of time. And I think the reality is people will stay at their jobs for less than 5 years. And yet we don't manage people and have a relationship that acknowledges that. Mm-hmm. So one of the things we talk about at Altimeter is that the day you start is the day we talk about the day you leave. Because we know at some point you're going to leave. So let's have an open dialogue and talk about this. And this plays into disruption because disruption is the major reason why people fight it is they think they're going to lose their job. And if you really believe that disruption is going to change organizations, then you have to have an honest conversation with people in that culture that says, you know, we are asking you to disrupt your job. We're asking you to get rid of your job, but we're going to take care of you. It's going to take us 6 months, 2 years to do this, and we will make sure that you have a place to go to so that you can do the disruptive thing that we're asking you to do. That's a very different type of relationship than most employers have today. And I think to be disruptive, you have to be disruptive in your culture, too, as well. And so the future of work is going to demand a very different type of relationship between employers and the employees, in that it's going to be much more of a contract. It's going to be very clear what you're coming into, what are the job responsibilities. And when I change as an employee in terms of my interests and my skills, what I want to do and develop and value, and you change as an employer what you value in your organization, your priorities, we're going to have an open dialogue around that. That changes. I mean, that's not the way work is done today. So when I think about the future of work, it's not just the hierarchies and structures. It's really about the fundamental way we approach work as both an organization and also as people who work there.
Part of that reminds me about what we were talking about before with the intrapreneur. Mm-hmm. I think you were telling me about how you wanted to leave to start this business based on that entrepreneurship that you hadn't really focused on within yourself. How is that play into any of the future of the workplace?
It does, because I think, again, if organizations can tap employees and encourage them to follow these passions that they would normally take outside of the organizations and harness that innovation internally, employee, you want to invest in new ideas, that employee knows your business and your customers really well. Entrepreneurship is a fantastic form of disruptive innovation. The problem is most companies aren't set up for that. So if you want to be truly innovative, you have to usually leave versus saying, hey, can I pursue that passion here? What are my skills, my strengths that I can contribute to the mission and purpose of this organization? So, you know, one of the key tenets that Google has about being innovation is having a very clear sense of mission and purpose. So are we aligned in that? And if you are aligned in that, then you can make things work.
Well, I'll tell you, sitting here has made me want to work for Altimeter Group now.
I hope so. I'm gonna think about it. It'd be great.
But until that happens, I'm going to design my own exit. I'm kidding.
I think one of the key things around working at a place is really understanding that strength that you bring in. And so a lot of the work that we do at Altimeter is understanding people's strengths and also knowing that it changes over time. So having that constant dialogue and knowing that this is a relationship that doesn't exist just only in this time and space of your employment at the company, it's going to extend further on too as well. So there's no such thing as lifetime employment, but there are lifetime relationships that we have to manage now. And if you think about things in that frame of mind, then we would approach that relationship right when you begin, right when you were doing the recruitment and having those conversations of how you're going to begin that relationship in a very, very different way. So I look at organizations, I look at people like Netflix, who have a fantastic culture, very open in that way, and very open dialogue around that. LinkedIn also has conversations with people around the tour of duty. Mm-hmm. The traditional consulting firms like McKinsey said it very clearly. You're going to be here for 2 years, and then we expect you to leave. Mm-hmm. You're going to have an up and out. We're going to have a very clear progression of what the expectations are, because that is the kind of culture and professionalism we want. And I think having that kind of culture, and you can have it in very structured organizations, meritocracies, mm-hmm. unionized environments, but it is a different way, I think, again, of people thinking about that relationship with their employees.
It's interesting. I just read that Netflix has no vacation policy.
We don't either.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
And what do you so obviously you believe in that, and how's that working?
We just started it this year, okay. So I'll let you know.
Okay.
The idea is that we're not looking at the number of hours that people put in. I mean, no, people work really hard at different hours of the day. So why are we tracking how many hours they spend at the dentist or doing whatever? You know, you have life, you have work, and we're not looking for balance, we're looking for harmony. So how do you have harmony between the two so that they are working really well? We really hire against values, and I know Netflix does too. And I think being, again, hiring against values makes it so much easier because we know that the people coming in are care passionately about what we're trying to do. And so because of that, we know they're going to put their 100% energy into this. And we have a dialogue about what the expectations are. And if you're not meeting those expectations, if you feel like you're letting down the team and not pulling your weight, we're going to have a conversation around that.
Well, we've got just a couple minutes left, so I just wanted to ask you just real quickly to go over what you see in the future. What is your, I mean, you've got this book that you're mm-hmm. working on. Is there any kind of insights that you can give us?
And yeah, the book is really around disruptive organizations and disruptive strategies. The tentative name is called The Disruptor's Agenda. Still working on the treatment for it. And it's really thinking about how do you systematize disruption and the role of this very important person, the disruptor. And what do they have to have as a checklist of things to do inside an organization to create that disruptive organization? But I also look at the future of work, continue to look at the social business space. One of the things I'm very excited to see is the 20th sort of anniversary of the World Wide Web this year. Mm. And we have a whole class of executives now. I call it the rise of the digital executive. These are a whole group of people coming into the prime of their leadership years in their 40s. Who have spent the entire professional career in the digital space, in the web. They will look at this world in a completely different way than the people like myself who are sort of Gen X, who kind of like, yeah, I can kind of fake my way through it. They are born and bred in this space. And we will see a very different type of engagement. They will know how to use all these tools to be effective leaders. So that's going to put a lot of pressure on people like my generation who are like, I still don't get it. You know, is it really real? So
I'm still trying to Snapchat.
So. Yeah, it is. You know, it's just it's a constant, right? It doesn't say the other stuff goes away. But if you're going to be an effective leader, and I work with a lot of executives and leaders, and I go, you know something that these young upstarts don't. You know what it means to be a leader. You know what it means to develop relationships. Now you just got to get somebody on your team who knows how to use these tools to do what you're trying to achieve. Mm. So the cheat sheet for executives in this digital age is don't focus on the tools and technologies, focus on the message, focus on the relationships you want to build. Then round out your team with people who know how to execute that, who can help you deliver that leadership message through all of these channels. So you don't have to learn how to use any of it. You just tell them, this is what I want to do. Find me the audience and the places where this message can get out. Because no one else can replace that leadership message other than you as a leader.
Wow. Wow. I could sit here and talk to you for hours, but unfortunately we're out of time, and I really appreciate it.
Sure
it's
thing.
It's been a pleasure talking to you, and we'll have to do this again sometime.
Okay,
but thank you very much.
Thank you.
I appreciate it.
Appreciate it.